মানের রহিম সম্মানিত প্রিয় দর্শক মণ্ডলী, আসসালামু আলাইকুম ওয়া রাহমাতুল্লাহি ওয়া বারাকাতুহ। সাদর আমন্ত্রণ জানাচ্ছি আপনাদের সকলকেই যে যেখান থেকে বসে আজকের চ্যারিটি ইন প্রোগ্রেস অনুষ্ঠানটি দেখছেন। আশা করছি আপনারা সবাই ভালো আছেন এবং আপনাদের ভালো থাকার প্রত্যাশা আমাদের সব সময়ের জন্য। আপনারা জানেন চ্যারিটি ইন প্রোগ্রেস অনুষ্ঠান আমরা সাজিয়ে থাকি বিভিন্ন ধরনের চ্যারিটি সংগঠনের তাদের প্রোগ্রেস সম্পর্কে জানার জন্য এবং বিস্তারিত তাদের অর্গানাইজেশন সম্পর্কে আমরা তারা বিগত দিনে কী কী কাজ করেছেন, কী কী কাজ করছেন এবং ভবিষ্যতে কী পরিকল্পনা আছে এই সব বিষয় নিয়ে আমরা চেষ্টা করি চ্যারিটি ইন প্রোগ্রেস অনুষ্ঠানে আলোচনা করার। আজও ইনশাআল্লাহ তার ব্যতিক্রম হবে না। টুডে উই হ্যাভ উইথ আস আল ইশারা, আ চ্যারিটি অর্গানাইজেশন দ্যাট ডেডিকেটস ইটসেলফ, ফোকাসেস অন দি ডেফ কমিউনিটি ও দি মুসলিম কমিউনিটি, দি ডেফ চিলড্রেন ও দি ডেফ পিপল উইদিন আ মুসলিম কমিউনিটি। উইল ফাইন্ড আউট ফ্রম দেম, what does it mean, what sort of responsibilities do they have, what sort of projects are they involved in, and how are they actively involved with the deaf community. All of this and many more we'll inshallah try and discuss in our tonight's discussion. But in any event, formalities must be proceeded with. I have three respectable guests with us in the studio, and if I can start from my right, I have Brother Shamsul Abidin, who is the club leader, HNK Cycle Club. And on my left, I've got immediate left, Azad Hussein, who is the head of operation for Al Isharah. And to his left, we have Brother Amin Habib, who is a teacher at Al Isharah. First of all, Assalamu alaikum and welcome to the program.
Wa alaikum assalam.
Now, if I can start with you, Brother Azad Hussein, because as you are the head of operation, so I can understand by the title, a lot of responsibilities you have on your shoulder. Now, if you can briefly give me an idea about, especially to our viewers who are not very familiar with Al Isharah, what is Al Isharah and what sort of work is Al Isharah doing within the community?
Okay. Bismillah wa salatu wa salamu ala Rasulillah. So Al Isharah is a deaf services provider that was born in the heart of the Muslim community. And we essentially came about because there was a realization that the Muslim deaf community do not have enough resources to learn about their faith, because quite honestly their learning methods are quite different to the rest of the community. And in effect, before the existence of Al Isharah, many Muslim children, deaf Muslim children who are growing up, did not have a understanding of their faith.
Now, I want to ask you here, is Al Isharah first of its kind to work solely and dedicatedly towards the deaf community, or was there any other organization like that?
Yes, there have been other reputable organizations also. There's another organization known as Muslim Deaf UK. Okay. And they've also, mashallah, been doing some brilliant work for a while now.
And how did Al Isharah come into being then?
So from what I understand, Muslim Deaf UK are based in Leicester.
Okay.
Al Isharah essentially came about, it was founded by a deaf man by the name of Sadaqat Ali.
So it was founded by a deaf man?
A deaf man, yes.
Okay, interesting.
And what happened was, the story behind it was a lady came to him and said, I have a deaf daughter and I have nowhere to teach her Islam. And essentially this is where this brainwave came, and from there onwards, alhamdulillah, now we have three schools teaching Islam to deaf children.
I'll come to the three schools. That's very interesting. And I must mention, Al Isharah, last year in 2017 Ramadan, they had two appeals on Channel S. One for particularly deaf community, for the projects. And the other appeal was especially for a Quran that should be read by the deaf children or the deaf adults. And we'll try and find out what does that involve. Because normally we understand Quran as a normal Mus'haf, and for all of us who are, alhamdulillah, fortunate enough to hear, we've got good sound, we do not understand, we do not realize how difficult it is for people who have hearing impairment and who cannot understand or who cannot listen to the beautiful voices of the Quran. We'll try and find out a little bit more in our program. Now, I'll come back to you, Brother Azad Hussein, but before that, I want to move on to Brother Amin Habib, who's also from Al Isharah. And now, you're a teacher. Now, when you say a teacher, people might understand you might be, because the normal understanding of teacher is you're teaching children well able, physically fit, and those do not have any kind of health issues. Now, are you involved with the deaf community children, or are you involved with all-rounded, all other children that are involved in the group?
So the structure of the classes are staged, so you have different levels of students.
Okay.
All students in the BSL classes or in the...
when you say BSL, class, if you can slide the...
So BSL standing for British Sign Language.
Okay.
They're ranked by the level of hearing.
Okay.
So you have students that are profoundly deaf, you have students that are hard of hearing, and you have students that have a okay level of speaking, hearing. And the students that I teach primarily are the ones that have a decent level of hearing.
So that means there's a spectrum of hearing then?
That's correct. That's
right. Okay. Yeah. So now, how do you teach them?
So it's a combination of teaching methods. So it's my second year of teaching, and I found that with students, deaf students, they kind of have a very visual, strong visual approach to teaching. They're very reliant on presentations, pictures, images, mm-hmm. more than sound. Because with teaching a deaf child, the challenge is you may say something, and to yourself, because you're well of hearing, it's easy for you to think, okay, I've said something, you should understand it. I've heard it perfectly fine. But it's very easy to forget that even amongst the students that you have, the 10 or so students in your class, each of them are varying levels of deafness.
Mm-hmm.
Some they all have cochlear implants to amplify the sound. However, some students have higher thresholds of listening, whereas others have weaker thresholds or lower thresholds of listening.
What about the hearing aid?
So the hearing aid is what we call the cochlear implant.
Okay.
And that helps to try and amplify noise. However, at the same time, this same implant that is the hearing aid
mm-hmm.
picks up sound from different areas as well. So it's
okay.
not just your voice that they're hearing, but they're hearing all the ambient noise around them. And that can sometimes make listening for the students quite difficult. So for me personally, the challenge is not just speaking or them understanding what I have to say, but it's trying to find other methods, i.e. via maybe sign language or presentations or images or pictures to try and help them understand.
So in short, basically, there is no one method to teach the group. There are different methods that you might need to follow mm. just to ensure that each of the children are heard equally and given the same attention.
Exactly.
Thank you very much. I'll come back to you, inshallah. Now, Brother Shamsul Abidin, club leader of HNK Cycle Club. Now, first of all, if I can start, what's HNK Cycle Club?
So HNK actually stands for Hope and Knowledge.
Okay.
It's pretty much about 4 to 5 years old now. Initially, Hope and Knowledge is an organization. We're not registered charity.
Okay.
We're just a bunch of volunteers that wanted to do good within the community. So the initial founders, which was about four brothers and sisters, who started organizing trekking lectures, bringing shuyukhs from outside, international shuyukhs.
Okay.
And then they will try to find a cause that they want to help, and then look for a charity that can help them provide or to kind of deal with the cause, basically.
Now, so when you say cycling, this is something within the British Bangladeshi community, it's not that common. We hear about football, cricket, badminton and other things. Now, we rarely hear people go for, you know, a bicycle ride or a cycle ride, especially for charity purposes.
Yeah.
And I think it's something not too common within our community that we live in. So how did this idea of cycling come about?
Yeah, so amongst the activities that Hope and Knowledge used to do, i.e. trekking, running and all that, one of them was cycling. We did London to Paris with six brothers that went there and did it for a charity. And when they came back, the experience was challenging, but at the same time, for some reason, it became quite addictive, kind of catching the bug. And this was it. And then after the following year, we decided to do a regional ride from castle to castle, from Tower Bridge to Hever Castle. What we started calling it a regional ride within UK. Then every year we do a regional ride, and then we call it Three Cities, our flagship event.
Mm-hmm.
We go in Europe, cycling three European cities over 3 days, approximately 300 miles.
Oh, wow.
And subhanAllah, you said the cycling isn't much popular within Bangladeshi community. I would go further to say it's not even popular within Asian community.
Mm-hmm.
Cycling has always been known for the English people or the non-Asian.
Even, for example, Asian community, we can't think of going to work cycling. So let alone, we can't even think about it. So even our children, when they are into any cycling or things like that, as parents, we get worried. So I think from such sort of angle, I think there are certain fears, and especially when you read a lot of stories on the papers and on the news that you see, there's a lot of accident that takes place. I think community there did not know much about it. Now, when you talked about London to Paris, a couple of questions came to my mind. We've seen certain times, certain things have been said, for example, that wasn't a full journey, halfway journey, or there are mix and match, some parts you've done the cycling, the other parts it was through the car. So can you explain what was it? Is it through all through from London to Paris cycling, or was there a...
Well, London to Paris, I can take clearly, London to Paris was cycling from literally from LMC to Paris. The only bit that cannot be cycled is the English Channel, which was taken the ferry. Every one of our events, whether it's regional or is in Europe. I mean, so far we've covered London, Holland, Belgium, Germany, Switzerland, Austria.
So you've got to travel quite a lot of in the Europe then?
But just with pedaling, just with the pedal power. And none of the areas we've actually, because this is the mainland, there's no rivers to cross, we've pretty much been cycling all the way through.
That's great. Now, how did you get involved with Isharah?
So, Brother Azad, obviously, got in contact with us, and because every year we help out with different cause, with different charity. We try to remain independent and impartial. Hence why we try to find a charity that we'd like to work with. We kind of do the background research, because at the end of the day, when our riders are taking part and their friends and family are donating, we like to make sure that we do our due diligence, make sure that particular charity and the cause is fit for purpose.
Now, I would like to ask, when you use the word due diligence, how do you maintain that?
Well, within our core members of Help and Knowledge, we have brothers who are accountants, who have certain more background.
Is it fully transparent?
What, we?
The donations or the fundraise that you have, or all of those activities, is it fully transparent when it comes to financial activities?
Yes, that's the thing. We have to make sure that the charity that we want to help, i.e. in this case, Isharah, that they are fully transparent and they're fully registered within the UK charity. And once we're confident that these people, we like to work with them, that's when we can pass on to our riders, hence the family and friends can donate, and we can feel comfortable, confident to say we've done our background research on their behalf.
Thank you very much. I'll come back to you, inshallah, Brother Amin Habib. Shams al-Abidin.
Nice.
Sorry for that. Brother Azad Hussain, we talked about transparency. Now, as I understand, is Isharah registered with the Charity Commission?
Yes, alhamdulillah, we've been in existence since 2007. I believe in 2008, March was when we've had our registration.
It's almost 10 years now.
Yeah, exactly. This will be our 10-year anniversary, alhamdulillah.
Okay, alhamdulillah, a decade gone by.
A decade gone by of...
alhamdulillah. Now, for example, the biggest question that our viewers might have, or a lot of time we hear a lot of complaints that we receive, is how can the viewers or the donors, how can they get the surety that the money that they're donating are used for the rightful causes?
So it's a very good question, and with us it's slightly different. So what I mean by that is we are a services-based charity. Usually when, for example, you donate a pound and people are raising money for example, water in Palestine, for example, the question is how much of that pound goes towards buying water? With us, what happens is we basically, our donations go towards essential services such as teaching Islam, such as providing interpreters, such as providing other activities that deaf people can find a sense of inclusion, because our organization has a holistic kind of outlook. So our aim isn't just to help somebody in one element, one aspect of their life. So it's not just, for example, through an Islamic school on a weekend. It's through, we take a deaf person and we say, well, where is it that they require help? How is it that we can make them more integrated into society?
How do you identify that?
So there's a number of ways. Firstly, we are a grassroots charity. So we have a lot of deaf people. Our organization was born from a deaf person. Our trustees, our deaf people, or parents of deaf children. And our chairperson is also a deaf woman. So firstly, we are a grassroots organization. We have an acute understanding of where the needs are within the Muslim community. For example, if you look to a community, you can see, well, this so-and-so issues are not being tackled. For example, within the Muslim deaf community, deaf Islam is not being understood. You can tell that just through interaction. You can tell that there is higher rates of mental health issues amongst the deaf community. Statistics are there to prove that also. So then we can go about trying to establish services for doing that. Now, with regards to donation-wise, alhamdulillah, we have a very dedicated team of workers as well as volunteers. And some of our workers, even sometimes, they work beyond their capacity, volunteering at times, even when they're not working. So sometimes people ask the question, is this 100% charity? I would say we're 110% charity, if that makes sense.
Okay.
Because just to give credit to our staff and volunteers, the amount of work they do.
Jazakallah khair for that. Priya darshak, amra shunchilam deaf community সাথে যারা কাজ করেন তারা হচ্ছেন আল ইশারা আমরা যারা কানে শুনি এটা কত বড় একটি আল্লাহর নেয়ামত যা আমরা হয়তো কল্পনা করতে পারি না যারা কানে শুনেন না এবং কি কি জিনিস তারা শুনছেন না আমরা মধুর কণ্ঠে যখন কোরআনের তেলাওয়াত শুনি বা কোনো ধরনের নাশিদ শুনি আমরা উপভোগ করতে পারি একটা বিউটি অফ দ্য ভয়েস কিন্তু যারা কানে শুনে না এবং সবচেয়ে গুরুত্বপূর্ণ বিষয় যে আমার সশ্রদ্ধেয় ভাই যিনি বামে বসা আছেন তিনি বলেছেন যে Quran by Islamic shikhata koto challenging deaf community journal. How important it is for us as Muslim community to take such responsibility. Karon eta amader daitto tara tader next generation ke kirokom Quran pouche debe kar ei onek deaf community moddhe mashallah tara sharirik bhabe onno sob dik diye kintu pure pure shusto achen kintu din jodi na bujhen tale kemne tara ei Islam ke tara towards the next generation propagate korben এবং চ্যানেলস এটাকে দায়িত্ব সহকারে নেয় এবং এরকম ইউনিক প্রজেক্ট আমরা তুলে ধরার চেষ্টা এই জন্যই করি কারণ প্রথমে তারা মুসলিম কমিউনিটি যে ডেফ কমিউনিটি এত বড় একটি কমিউনিটি আছে যেটা আমাদের এই বিলেতে আছে তাদের জন্য ডেডিকেটেড হিসাবে ডেডিকেটেডলি কাজ করে যাচ্ছে এবং গত রমজান মাসে আলহামদুলিল্লাহ আপনাদের দেয়া ডোনেশনের মাধ্যমে প্রজেক্ট দুইবার আপিল হয়েছে এখানে এই রমজান মাসে এবং আপনাদের দেয়া দানের বিনিময়ে তারা বহু ধরনের প্রজেক্ট তারা সাকসেসফুল করেছেন এবং বিভিন্ন ধরনের চ্যালেঞ্জেসও রয়েছে তার জন্য সবসময় প্রথম জিনিস যেটা আমরা চ্যালেঞ্জ থেকে তুলে ধরার চেষ্টা করি যে ট্রান্সপারেন্সি যেটা বলেছেন এখানে যে প্রত্যেকটি চ্যারিটি অর্গানাইজেশন আমরা প্রথমে নিশ্চিত করি চ্যানেলসে যে হাউ ট্রান্সপারেন্ট ইট ইজ এবং তারা কীরকম কাজ করছেন ইনশাল্লাহ আমরা আরও কথা শুনবো এই অর্গানাইজেশন সম্পর্কে এবং পার্টিকুলারলি তাদের যে কাজ ডেফ কমিউনিটিকে নিয়ে আরও আমরা তাদের কাছ থেকে জানার চেষ্টা করব নাও ব্রাদার আজাদ We talked about Quran, mm-hmm. you know, the deaf Quran. Yeah. Slightly touch on that. What is that?
So the deaf Quran, within the Muslim community, the resources, like I said, for Muslims to learn Islam is almost nil. There's no Quran that a deaf person can access. Because we may say a deaf person can't hear, but they can read. But the reality is a deaf person's cognitive construct, how they think, is completely different. As Brother Amin said, deaf people, they can't simply read. They've tried that in the past. They've tried to ban sign language and things like that in British history.
Now, I have a question here. For example, those who are deaf, that doesn't necessarily mean they're blind or the other physical activities or the other organs, alhamdulillah, they must be working fine. So some may ask, so what difference does it make? Why can't they read the Quran? Because they can actually see it.
This is a fantastic question. And basically, just to clarify on that, in the 1880s, they had a conference known as the Conference on the Educators of Deaf.
1880?
Yeah, 1880. Okay. And what they done was effectively where educators of deaf came together in Milan and they effectively banned sign language. Banned sign language for
Why
teaching purposes. So they saw what they wanted was for deaf people to learn through a more oral system, what they call oralism. So they wanted deaf people to learn through reading and writing.
Okay.
So they done that and many deaf people lost their job, deaf people suffered, sign language was almost destroyed. And what happened was they realized that deaf people were learning to read and write, but they wasn't understanding this. And there was a reason for that. With us, what drives our thinking is we have an inner voice. So a deaf person who doesn't have a voice, who can't hear themselves, what is their inner voice?
But they can speak.
They can, for example, a deaf person who has never heard a sound, they can't mimic that same sound in the same way.
Okay.
They can't make that sound because they've never heard that sound. A fully deaf person, that is. So they don't have an inner voice in the same sense that we have an inner voice. Our inner voice drives our thought process. So a deaf person's inner voice is visualization. So that's why immediately deaf people, they always need more visual things. So they found that deaf people were able to read and write, but they didn't understand what they were reading and writing.
So it's not the same as people who have the full ear, hearing facility.
So our brain actually works differently. A deaf brain works differently. So that's why with you need a deaf Quran, or a visual representation. So last year, again, this has been a realization and an aspiration within the deaf community for decades. Was probably as long as there has been deaf Muslims. And what we wanted to do was make a visual representation of the words of Allah. Now, you may ask, how necessary is this? For example, now imagine you have a fully deaf child. That child, we know the obligation upon them is still to pray.
Yes.
So now how do they recite Surah Fatiha, for example? They've never heard Surah Fatiha. So again, now we teach them signs for Surah Fatiha. And they...
Oh, so actually there is a sign language for the Qur'an.
That is something we're developing.
Okay, it's something unique,
I think. This is where the BSL Qur'an comes in specifically. So this is something we've developed. And now, for example, right now, some of the basic surahs have been developed enough for deaf people to fulfill their salah with the very basics. So now, when a deaf person is praying, for example, he can visualize in his mind, you would be reciting and contemplating, he would be visualizing the signs which make Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, for example, and so on and so forth.
So they might not necessarily be reciting it or repeating the word. They can't.
But they'll be visualizing it in their mind. They'll be imagining these signs.
JazakAllah khair for that. Priyo darshak, amra shunchilam Al Isharah organization kortipokor kach theke je kirokom tara Quran, je deaf Quran jake bole, kirokom tara Quran shekhatchen ebong eta already under development ache. Ebong amra jani goto Ramadan mashe apnader deya donation er maddhome ei project ti onek এগিয়ে যাচ্ছে এবং আমরা তাদের কাছ থেকে ব্রেক থেকে আসার পরে জানার আরও চেষ্টা করব কতদূর তারা এই কাজটিকে এগিয়েছেন এবং কী কী চ্যালেঞ্জের সম্মুখীন হতে হচ্ছে। এবং সবচেয়ে ইম্পর্টেন্ট বিষয় হচ্ছে যে আমাদের আজাদ ভাই বলেছেন যে তাদের উপরেও তো কোরআন এবং ইসলাম নামাজ পড়া তো ফরজ আছে। আমরা যদি না শেখাই, আমরা যদি এই নলেজটাকে যদি এটাকে আরও এলাবোরেট না করি, তাহলে তাদের জন্য কীরকম সম্ভব এই সব শেখা? আমরা ইনশাআল্লাহ বিরতির পরে আসার পরে আমরা আরও আলোচনা করব যে এখানে সাইক্লিংয়ের কথা বলা হয়েছে, কীরকম সাইক্লিং হচ্ছে, কীরকম ডোনেশন তোলা হচ্ছে এবং কারা কারা অংশগ্রহণ করতে পারবেন, এইসব বিষয় নিয়ে আমরা ইনশাআল্লাহ ছোট্ট বিরতির পর আবার আমরা আলোচনা করবো। ইনশাআল্লাহ আমাদের সঙ্গেই থাকবেন। আসসালামু আলাইকুম।